Check 1, 2. Deep Ellum on air.
Right, you're on mute.
Deep Ellum on air.
It's time to really get our party on now.
Right, you're hearing the remix of Jedigoddess Presents.
Wicka wicka wah!
Wicka wow! Yow!
It's been a while since we've been back, so hello everyone. Glad to see everyone. Hope everyone had a beautiful Easter and great holiday. As you can see, we're charged up and ready to go. So, I'm your host, Christy Jedigoddess. Hello, internets. To my right, we have the maestro, Christopher Moore, joining us.
Thank you. Red 5 standing by.
And to the right of the right, we have Konnichiwa Zach.
Oh, looks like I picked the wrong week to quit sniffing glue.
Wow.
And our special guest today, oh my God, Jason Schalker. Hello.
Insert witty comment here.
That was witty. And of course, our man in the distance, the ghost of Patrick Swayze, our EP, Michael Lukacki.
She's out the way.
And of course, Jansen Ray being awesome behind the controls.
Welcome back.
Yeah. With his awesome scooter. Oh my God.
You like that?
I love it. This scooter's so cool. Gotta put a Jedigoddess sticker on it, though.
It's fun.
Actually,
I wear a cape when I ride it sometimes.
You know what you need? You need Scooter the Muppet on there somehow. That would be the jam.
Oh my God. I love Muppets. Muppets are coming back, too.
Yes, big announcement there. ABC's bringing them back, but that's not a surprise since Disney owns the Muppets and Disney and ABC are in cahoots.
And Disney are really good at just marketing over and over again. But they're really good about that.
Yeah, and in a good way. It's not a, you know, it's like, oh, God, do we have to deal with this?
No, Muppets are awesome.
Yeah.
But actually, to start out, so our news update guy here, Mr. Moore, Star Wars news, geek news, what's our news roundup for
today?
Oh,
man, this was an actually nice little appetizer week of Star Wars news. Big one being that all of you folks who prefer to go digitally with your content, owning libraries and movies, well, guess what, folks? All six of the Star Wars films that are in existence right now are now available on all major digital outlets. Netflix, Amazon Prime, iTunes. You can buy them for a digital file or streaming any way that you want it. Now, big clincher here is that the original trilogy is not included. These are the special edition episodes 4 through 6, excuse me. And then, of course, 1 through 3, which, you know, shall remain nameless for some. But all six are available, and the bundles are actually priced at $90, which is a good thing, because individually they're $20 on iTunes.
Yeah, and I think on Amazon, though, I will say this, I think about $85 to $89 is the Blu-ray edition for them all, too. So that makes sense. But, you know, with everything going digital and the streaming age and stuff like that, it's a good way to go. And we'll talk about that a little bit, too.
Absolutely. We've got a whole section on digital, the digital frontier, as it were, for consumer content. Continuing on with news, the big one is April 16th, there's a big Star Wars Celebration event going on, and that will be the first time that we get a second teaser trailer for The Force Awakens, as well as a new poster, and of course all that's going to get leaked to the internet, so for you guys who would like to avoid spoilers, look out. Those are the big ones.
So wait, can you go into kind of the detail on the Star Wars Celebration? Because I mean, isn't this like a big industry type thing or a con thing, or what exactly is the Star Wars Celebration?
Usually, there are several different cons of that kind. These are specifically for Star Wars fans. They happen internationally. They've happened here, and a lot of them go on in, like, at the Disney parks. This one I don't have as many details on, but if you're there, a lot of Star Wars fans already know about it. I expect you know a lot about
it. Oh, yeah. Well, I remember Celebration, too. I have never been to it, but I've always wanted to go. But I used to get collectibles and all this stuff that come down the line, because whenever you go there, there's usually door things they give you. You have swag bags. But it's the biggest celebration for Star Wars. It's actually specifically for Star Wars, excuse me, and it commemorates the entire franchise. You have cosplayers, anything you can think of, people are there.
So this is kind of around the Anaheim area. This is around, like, Skywalker Ranch and things like that, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like, I went to Celebration 1. I lived in Boulder at the time, so just went down to Denver, and they had, like they had the actual pod racers props from, because it was right before Episode 1 came out, and so they actually had tons of props from the movies, costumes, and granted, it was the first one, so I'm sure it's evolved significantly since then. Mm. But I know they normally have like exclusives, and they'll have a ton of Force Awakens stuff that will be, you know, everybody will be drooling over and all that good stuff.
So. Absolutely. One last, on a personal note, a lot of people are very divisive on this point, but John Williams is in excellent health, and he will be writing the music for The Force Awakens. In fact, there are some people who speculate this new trailer will have new music from Williams. But on the heels of that news, Star Wars Rogue One, the Gareth Edwards-directed Star Wars standalone film, will have music by none other than Alexander Desplat, who recently won an Academy Award.
Mm-hmm. For Grand Budapest Hotel.
Absolutely.
Your trumpets, kids.
There you go. And one of Gog's favorite films. But on top of this, it's easy to see that this was going to happen because Alexander Desplat is like an heir apparent to John Williams' work since he inherited the Harry Potter franchise for the last two films and worked with Gareth Edwards before on last summer's excellent Godzilla. And that score is fantastic in its construction.
Yeah, and even I'll say this. I love Harry Potter, but I thought the score was actually really, really well done, too.
Yeah, absolutely. The first three were fantastic. I think the weakest one is probably... for the weakest movie, the sixth to last two films, the Half-Blood Prince.
There's
I thought that was the weakest story.
85 movies of Harry Potter. So.
Yeah, and there's about to be more because apparently Eddie Redmayne, who just won an Academy Award as well for The Theory of Everything, will be in, and this is off topic, of course, for Star Wars, but it's still good news because Eddie Redmayne will probably end up in a Star Wars movie at some point. It's bound to happen.
Yeah.
But he will be in Fantastic Beasts, I believe is the title. It's J.K. Rowling's screenwriting debut, mm-hmm. and it's set in the world of Harry Potter, but will not necessarily include Harry Potter. This was just recently announced.
It's your favorite land, Kazakh.
Yeah, and if Julia Roberts shows up soon.
And Keanu.
Yeah, I'm sure. And yeah, she got the rights to produce and star in the dramatization of the Bat-Kid story. Which I thought was cool. You may think she'll bastardize it. I might see it. It depends. It just got a summer release date. For Bad Kid, I'm sorry, a lot of people are going to take issue with this. I mean, a documentary alone on this thing would be fine, but it's just gotten so...
Well, there is a documentary on it, but I think there's also a feature-length film that they're going to produce
Julia Roberts is doing the feature-length one,
You know, and I'm going to jump onto a topic, too, what we were talking about, like the streaming and stuff. What just hit Netflix? Daredevil.
Yes!
So... I really want to talk about that. So I've seen the first episode. I know our magical ghost of Patrick Swayze has seen nine of them. But I want to get everyone else's opinion of, you know, Daredevil. Because I know you've seen the first episode, correct?
Right. I got to see the first episode. Because I don't recognize who Daredevil is. I know that you've got these inside tracks. Isn't it someone from, like, Game of Thrones or something like that?
What?
Charlie Cox is playing Daredevil, and most people will know him from Stardust if they know him from anything at all.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because he's a relatively unknown and excellent actor.
Stardust is a great movie too, and that's with that's based off a Neil Gaiman novel, and it has Michelle Pfeiffer and Robert De Niro in it. Just a little inside point. But okay, Daredevil. Because did you read the comics on that, Chris?
I read the Ultimate Daredevil and Elektra comic, but I've been familiar with the character for years. It's a unique and very special character, and this is where I think Gok should jump in from the comic book perspective specifically.
Yeah, Head Kaiju in charge is going to jump in on this conversation.
He should.
Yeah, the Daredevil look. I watched a ridiculous amount of it, right? So I spent Saturday binge-watching Daredevil and watched 10 episodes. The comic that really informs it is, to me, the Bendis and Maleev run, the Brian Michael Bendis, Alex Maleev run that happened a few years ago. It's brilliant. It has a very, very unique look. There's Frank Miller all over this thing, too, but I would really say that Alex Maleev look is the look that they took for the series. It's filmed very, very dark. Lots of shots in low light and stuff. Lots of slow pacing. That's one thing that I'm kind of torn on with it, is that it's really slow paced. The conversations are good and everything, but I'm most of the way through the season, and I would say we've seen the amount of action that you would typically see in a show, and I don't just mean fight scenes, I mean in terms of real story movement, we've seen the amount of action of about 5 episodes of a typical show. So it's moving really slow, sometimes too slow. They just showed a shot of Scott Glenn, who's stick in the thing, man. He is amazing.
I love Scott Glenn.
Casting was brilliant all the way around. Charlie Cox, it took me a minute to get sold on him, but I ended up getting sold on him pretty well.
Right, he's in Boardwalk Empire. That's what I was looking for. One of the HBO shows, I know.
Yeah. And the girl from True Blood, well, there's another HBO connection. What's her name?
Deborah Ann Woll.
Deborah Ann Woll. Yes, she ends up playing Karen Page, who I thought it was a great cast. Great character from the comic. Not necessarily sure what they're doing with her on the show, but loved her choice as the cast. And D'Onofrio is amazing.
I'm definitely looking forward to seeing D'Onofrio develop as the Kingpin.
Because not in the first episode.
I know, not in the first episode, but like I said, I know that he's coming. I know that I'm going to get to see this really intense actor take on this really powerful role.
The Kingpin's just so rich in
that whole mythos that as they get into stuff like what they're doing with the Defenders and things like that, and the other three Netflix series that Marvel is producing, I'm really looking forward to seeing how that all ties in and develops.
And they're on their way because Kristen Ritter has been cast in AKA Jessica Jones as the title character. They're already shooting. They've got a showrunner for Luke Cage. I forget what the third series is going to be, but you're right.
It's Iron Fist.
That's going to be cool. I hope they go real like old school kung fu on that, but they probably won't. They'll probably have some other style they'll choose. But that's a show that's going to need more action than what Daredevil seems to be showing based on.
When's the last time somebody's really tapped into what Bruce Lee, the magic that Bruce Lee had about film?
Dragon, the Bruce Lee story, was probably the last movie I can think of that does that right, other than what actually goes on in Asian cinema that you guys are probably far more tapped into than me.
Mm-hmm.
I remember we were talking with Joey O'Brien about some of his involvement with a lot of that stuff, and that stuff was really cool. You know, those kinds of things like Full-Time Killer.
So, hey, last word on Daredevil, and then I'm going to jump out of the conversation and give the show back to y'all. But last word on Daredevil from Christy. You watched the first episode. Mm-hmm. What was your reaction to the tone and everything like that?
I thought the tone was really good. It was dark. Something that you mentioned that caught my eye was kind of like the kind of a police drama a little bit. It kind of has that ambiance to it, but you can tell there's like this height of almost surreal to it. It's like a surreal cop drama is the first episode to me, which is really weird to describe that, but you can almost tell there's like a height of something coming. But I'm only one episode in. I love Deborah Ann Woll on there too, because I loved her as Jessica on True Blood. So I
And so did everyone else on that show.
Yes. She's blonde in this, by the way. She's not the redhead.
Oh, damn.
She's totally blonde. In this, I'll put that out there.
But I mean, the dark tones have got to be intentional because you're dealing with a character who's blind. So I mean, the light isn't necessarily as important. You want to get that point of view.
That's a great point. Him. Yeah, the way they filmed it, because you saw it too, just like how the lighting is, like just light through the window. You know, it's really weird because you're walking to something very dark, but it's kind of pulling you into that kind of ambiance. I love that kind of stuff. I love it when your brain is kind of surreal. You can tell there's like this supernatural almost effect to it. So I'm you know, I'm only one episode in, but that's my first take on it. I thought the dialogue was really good. It went back and forth cleanly. It didn't seem over-rehearsed or anything like that. So those are little things. I don't normally watch a lot of series just because, for the very reason, I don't want to spend a decade getting to the point. You know, that's why I like movies.
Yeah. But, you know, three points about that is, one, they're in a situation where they set it up so you could binge watch it and watch it basically a 13-hour movie.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, I know we're getting to that stage of the discussion,
right.
But they also, because we're in that instantaneous age with the internet, they're also blowing a lot of their spoilers in advance for people who just haven't gotten over to it yet. Like the suit has already been made available as a motion poster. And I don't know if he gets to wear it in this season at any particular point, but we know early on he wears the black, where it's over his head, that sort of thing.
It's kind of like the Dread Pirate Roberts is his costume to start off with, which is totally what I done. And I was like, yes!
And that's straight out of the comic that Gok was mentioning. So the interesting point about that is that if they're not careful, they're going to blow their leads before they actually get a chance to entertain people, even though they know the binge-watching is out there. So they got to play this one just very carefully. That's the other side of having shows like this out there, is control your marketing still. It's even more important to do that than you would with, say, a show on network television, because you have that steady control of, we're just airing this one this week.
You know, and this is interesting, too, and I'll probably talk about this about a little bit later, but, you know, the evolution kind of how virtual films and that evolution of streaming and all that goes too, but we'll talk about that a little bit later. But first I wanted to bring Jason and talk a little bit about our special guest.
Yes.
So Jason Chalker. Hi, how are you? Welcome
to
Jedigoddess Presents. Thanks for coming on. So I would love to talk to you. Why don't you tell us a little bit about you and what you do?
Well, I'm a illustrator and graphic designer. I do a lot of freelance work for Tops, mostly sketch cards and stuff for Mars Attack, Star Wars,
done some wacky packages stuff.
Oh, yes. Tick ticks.
And I also do work for Upper Deck. I've been working on Marvel sketch cards starting late fall. So those card sets are just starting to release. And that's what I do currently. And whatever else people pay me for so I can pay the bills.
Not too shabby.
Yeah.
Well, when you say tops and stuff, does that mean you're like an official Lucas approved artist?
Well, it's not quite as
formal,
glamorous as that, I would say. I don't know how much Lucasfilm actually goes into like the actual sketch cards that people do. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'm at least the tops approved, and they have a license from Lucas. So, you know, I'm
in a roundabout.
Like I'm one, you know, like what is it? Just one generation removed from being an official. You know.
I can the just guy touch
behind
Obi-Wan.
The guy behind the guy behind the guy.
I'm this
I'm the
far.
Dude. That's the dude.
But I guess I do official Star Wars art because it gets released in Star Wars packages. So yeah,
so that does count. Yeah. Congratulations on that. I know we have a couple of images of your artwork that we'll stream through as well. And see if you can see them. If you want to tell, this is on your T-shirt right now, actually.
Yeah, that's a character I did. I had a two-man show with Scott Kinnebrew at Kid Robot in New York a few years ago, and I'd come up with this character, Pimp2D2.
Yeah,
because it was my basically. I was thinking, what if Star Wars been made as a droid exploitation film in the 70s.
Droid exploitation.
May the force of my pimp hand be upon you.
No, that's beep, 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 beep.
Beep, beep, boop.
Wait, I got it. Translation, bitch better have my money.
And this actually evolved. That was actually an NPC model kit I modified. And so, and unfortunately got destroyed coming back from Kid Robot in the mail.
Oh.
I've done I was like, you know, it's a 70s movie. It's got to have a toy line. So I've actually slowly been creating characters and casting resin, Kenner style 70s action figures of all the characters. So currently I have Pimp2D2 and C3P Ho.
If C-3PO were going to be anybody's bitch, it would be R2-D2. Yeah. So let's.
And there are more characters coming. I've been doing release. I've got a release coming up with DK Toys at San Diego Comic Con.
Oh, so, I can't
summer,
wait.
So that's going to be. I'll just say one word: pimp speeder.
Pimp speeder.
Yeah.
Wow. Does it do this?
It has rims. It has rims.
All the speeders do. They got the springs in them.
Yeah. They got that extra lift on the hover.
Yeah.
Activity. Yeah.
So I'm going to go ahead and point out another piece of Jason Chuck art. We're back to the picture. I'm sorry. This is another one.
You're still
okay. Yeah. So this T-shirt is available at Deep Ellum Trading Company next door to Deep Ellum Studios, which they've been kind enough to provide the whole cast of Jedigoddess Presents with these shirts. So we want to thank them. These were available at the Deep Ellum Arts Festival this week. And, of course, we have the man who designed them right here. So do check them out.
Your model.
Dude. This is how I roll. I'm so street.
Yeah, that's my superhero power is I can... If I have to make anything Star Wars, I can do it. Some way, some way, shape, or form, I can do that.
You have just made this lady's day.
Yay!
So in terms of your work with Topps, have you gotten to do any trading card activity or design any trading card work?
No, not yet. That's pretty highly prized work.
Yeah, I can imagine.
I did do a base card for a project that got scrapped or at least put on indefinite hold. And you're going to freak because I can already tell. They were going to do a line of Star Wars wacky packages.
Aww.
And I did a base card for that. It was Hoth Pockets. But unfortunately, may never see the light of day. And
that's okay. Hey, you know what? That'll come out in some kind of archival information years from now, maybe.
Maybe.
I don't know. Maybe not as a product, but at least photos. And, you know, that's virtually things tend to be treasured nowadays anyway, which seems to be a theme of our show.
I really feel bad for Randy Martinez. He's been doing a lot of the work for the Star Wars Illustrated sets that they're doing. And he did half the base cards for that Star Wars Wacky Package set. And it's just all like, you know, I mean, none of the actual cards are probably going to see the light of day anytime soon. So.
Wow.
Well, I see the reason for holding that back because next thing you know, it's Star Wars Garbage Pail Kids. And I think we got to draw the line there.
No, we don't.
I've done a Star Wars Garbage Pail.
I saw it. It was great.
Pukey Luke.
Nice!
He's throwing up in R2-D2's. He opened up R2-D2's head and he's throwing it up inside.
And he had the Hothrum, or was it the... There's a Tintin, or a Tauntaun or something.
Oh, it's like Old Tauntaun. It was like a bottle of booze. It's called Old Tauntaun.
That's
why Luke wanted to go to Tosche Station. It wasn't about the power converters. He was converting some, but it wasn't power.
Well, he was very whiny about those power converters, I'll be honest. Yeah.
He just needed his ripple.
Power converters. Need my jelly beans.
Stay on target.
So this is really dope here, this picture. Snoopy. I love Snoopy. Tell us about Snoopy.
Well, I love Snoopy too, obviously, being a child of the 70s. But that was always my favorite stories. I did that for an art show I had a number of years ago, and it's kind of managed to just stay in my repertoire of stuff, and it's one of my best-selling prints I've ever done.
Yeah, the detail is ridiculous.
And I did it kind of in the style of the pulp era, like Ace Comics, like the World War II fighter plane comics. That was kind of the look I was going for.
Well, I mean, now that we're getting that kind of a super CGI Peanuts film now.
Opening in November, yeah.
Don't say that too fast.
We're going to get
super CGI. You know what he was saying?
That's a whole different movie.
That's a whole WTF, dude.
That does not get mass distribution.
But, I mean, we're getting some more of the realism, and I think we're actually going to see probably more of a Red Baron fight, I think, in that.
Probably. I mean, the clip I've seen from it actually looks pretty cool. I mean, considering how they're, you know, because Schultz's style is so hard to convert to 3D and have it look like Schultz's style.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
The Charlie Brown squiggle thing is still a little weird. It's like this, like, is he growing like a rhinoceros hair tusk or something?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
But I don't know. I think it might be pretty cool, you know?
You know, I always wanted to see a live action Peanuts movie because I grew up watching, thanks to HBO, all the, they would air, you know, You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown, the Spelling Bee plot one, Race for Your Life, Charlie Brown, all of those. So it's nice to see the Peanuts come back to the movies.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it's... What are you laughing at?
Are you 12?
What?
That sounds funny when you say Peanuts.
But did it ever leave the movie? Oh, you mean the cartoon characters.
Yeah, sorry. Anyway, no, it's great to see them back, but I always wanted to see a live action one because I thought it would lend itself to that kind of thing, to that kind of storytelling. As long as it didn't devolve into something like a knockoff of The Sandlot or something like that.
Have you seen, there's actually a really cute laundry detergent commercial that has basically the Peanuts characters as kids.
Yeah.
They did a really good job with it, actually.
They did. It's not too far away, but I can see how hard that would be.
Yeah.
Because the Schultz trust is probably very specific about how they handle, who handles their properties.
Mm-hmm.
I know the Seuss estate was very unhappy with the Cat in the Hat, and we're lucky we got Horton Hears a Who and the Lorax from the rest of, you know, film properties. So
well, all that stuff has to get, like, goes through such a fine tooth comb of approval that, you can understand, though, because they're very protective of the image. I mean, I'm a big How the Grinch Stole Christmas. That's just my mecca when I was a kid. So that's why I was like, I understand that.
And on the same subject, Jason, when you go through your process of creating art, obviously when you do anything for Todd, take us through that process a little bit.
Well, I normally wait till the last minute, then in a dead panic.
I think every artist agrees with you in here.
Guilty! Short deadlines!
You know, it kind of depends on the subject matter. Like the Mars Attacks card, since there's not much precedent and we can't do anything from the movies, it's just all out of my head. So I just make up fun scenarios. But, basically the physical process is just, light pencil sketch. I do brush and ink with India ink, and then go in with watercolor and brushed ink to do the colors for it.
So. What's one of the iconic images that inspired you to get into this career, and have you created anything that you think met or exceeded that image?
Okay.
suddenly he went pro on him.
No.
This goes deep.
Well, I mean... What
really, easy now after what really
the two things that really pushed me into becoming an artist were when I was in third grade, Star Wars came out. I'm an old man. And around that time, I discovered The Hobbit and also the Brothers Hildebrandt, their calendar work. I picked up their art book. And those two things, I was like, wow, I want to do this. And so, it's been kind of a lifelong dream to do work for Topps. And granted, I'm not doing card art yet, hopefully. Hopefully that'll come to one day. But, I'm working on Star Wars. I'm working for Topps. They're a great company to work for, And it's just a lot of fun, you know, and I try to have fun in life.
You know, speaking of Star Wars, I have to talk about this miraculous thing you have in your house.
It looks like my office, actually.
You have a full room dedicated to Star Wars. Am I correct on this?
Yes, and actually, my wife came up with this all on her own.
Oh, I love her. I have to meet her. We have to bond.
Yes. She's got to be cool.
But the thing is, though, she's not really that much of a nerd. I mean, I've kind of pulled her into this world, and most kids our age and stuff, like, they liked Star Wars and everything. Mm-hmm. But she's just embraced and adopted it, and because she loves me, she turned our guest room into the Star Wars palace.
So does a lot of this get used as reference material when you're creating the cards?
No. I normally actually reference old trading cards, like my original set and stuff, and just find images on the internet and stuff. And sometimes I'll come up with, you know, characters I know really well. I'll, you know, like Boba Fett and stuff, I can kind of wing it. And
that's a pretty impressive.
I'm trying to give you an opportunity to write this off your taxes, because, yeah, I need those figures for
art. Oh, no, it is research, though. Yeah. I mean, because I make toys, too, so it's, you know, I'm researching how they're made and the quality and stuff like that.
Yeah, that's a pretty impressive collection.
It is. The fact
I was going to, we're geeking out now. Do you have a number of how many figures are in there?
Oh, God, I have no idea. And that's not all of them. I've got the jumbo Kenner re-release figures in my office. I've got about 20-something of those. Nice. I'm a little bit of a junkie, so.
That makes sense.
Hey, I'm sorry. Revenge of the Jedi poster, your cool points have gone through the window.
I got that at Spencer's at North Park Mall when I was in high school.
Very nice.
$10.
There you go.
I came this close to having one. My mom, at one point, she worked in a facility that was right next to an American Greetings distributor. So I got a lot of their one-off 24x36 posters as a kid. So tons of Return of the Jedi swag. Unfortunately, being a kid, that stuff gets torn up. The care didn't go into it that it needed to. And so, unfortunately, it's gone by the wayside. But I miss those posters. I really do.
That's the evolution of being a kid.
Needed to hell. I crashed my Millennium Falcon in the bottom of Tatooine sandboxes all the time.
Come on, man. Those cats.
They were there for.
I was going to say, too, let's take a look at what you're creating for us, Jason. Just lift it. We're doing a little Mars Attacks action going on there. That's pretty awesome. Look at that. I can't wait to see what it's going to look like at the end.
There we go.
And we'll have to give him a bit of a break to do that. But I want to, before we move on, I want to talk about, since you work for Topps, Topps has this fantastic app, and I've got it on my iPhone, and it's a Star Wars cards trading app. You and I were talking about this before we got on air. And this, honestly, this is a great way. I mean, I mentioned before I got on air, I had all these cards. I had almost the entire line of the Return of the Jedi cards. Got a lot of swag for that movie. It was great to be alive in 1983 as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
But unfortunately, I sold them all at one point, and it was the stupidest thing I've ever done. But virtually, I find I can get back all the comic books and cards that I never got. So all of us being collectors, evidently, you very much so. What do you think of this app?
I think it's a lot of fun. You know, I mean, as we talked about earlier, I mean, I'll always take a physical trading card over a virtual one. But the great thing is it's a totally free app. I think it's a good, it's kind of a gateway drug for, you know, getting kids into buying physical cards. Cause you know, it's, the traditional trading cards that I'm used to are kind of a strange thing for kids. Cause kids these days, it's like, it's always trading card games.
Yes.
Stuff like that. And it's like, well, it doesn't do anything. It just, you know, cause that was our internet. Cause that's how we could relive the story.
It was more collecting
pictures and stuff like that. Yeah.
Collecting was exactly the way we got back into it. That's why we had book and record sets and the soundtrack albums and stuff.
And I had
the
story of Star Wars. I would, like, in third and fourth grade, I would come home every day from school and listen to that. Mm-hmm. So, but this is kind of fun, you know, and they have, like, special sets to come out, and every day you come in, you get like 25,000 credits to spend on your card sets. And it's a great little product, you know. I mean, in what, the 2 weeks, 2 or 3 weeks I've been on there, I've got I'm just shy of 2,000 cards.
Wow. And you said you had some Force Awakens cards, the ones we talked about earlier this year that have been out there as part of the buzz generation for the Force Awakens. And you said your handle on there was
ManlyArt.
How do I find you?
This
is not visually interesting to try to find this out. We'll have to do it after the show, perhaps. But
I think you go under.
So people can find
you go under social under the Death Star.
Okay, the Death Star.
Never thought I'd say that. Just go to social under the Death Star and press invite.
We got actually visualized cards.
Okay. Yeah, they're digitalized cards, and everything's going virtual and digital now. So
and
that's
pretty interesting. You can tap on them, it flips and gives you information about the story, like the old cards, Star Wars cards that had the stories on the back, part of the story on the back, or about that character. And so, yeah, it's a neat little app. It's kind of fun. It's still just as irritating getting doubles in the app as it was getting doubles in the pack. So, yeah.
I just found you, and I've checked you off, and I'm hoping that the invite works.
Perfect.
We'll see.
Now, what's the name of the app for people to download it?
It is literally called Star Wars Card Trader, and now I believe it's on iOS. I need to check into whether or not it's out there on Android, but I would not be surprised if it has been set up that way, because Android has a huge percentage of cell phone users right now.
Makes sense.
So it's coming, if it's not already.
I'll look into it, too. So what I want to do, because we're running into time, too, I wanted to talk a little bit about films and movies, if everyone's ready to do that.
Our favorite subject.
Speaking of, I'll tell you a little bit about this trailer that popped out. So part of our thing, we were talking about the Blacklist and all that kind of things. Blacklist is this famous, it used to be kind of underground Hollywood thing of films who, in scripts, who would hit the blacklist, meaning these are like the dream scripts. And this trailer right here is for Maggie with Arnold Schwarzenegger. And essentially, it's kind of like an Arnold Schwarzenegger zombie film, which is pretty crazy. That's the cliff notes of it. And people have been blowing up about it just because...
It's the approach is unexpected. It's not, you would assume that Schwarzenegger, it would be like him being on Walking Dead and kicking ass, but that is not what this is. Schwarzenegger's at a point in his career where he's making a comeback. He's come off of a scandal in the, as the Governator. And he's made a couple of, you know, just fun little clunker action movies.
Like Expendables and all that.
Well, you know, The Last Stand, which actually was a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. And he's back in this Terminator franchise now, as we've seen the trailer recently. But this is different. This is a drama. This is Schwarzenegger crying, trying to save his daughter. This is a
Abigail Breslin.
This is a human interest drama approach to the zombie. It's not like your George Romero approach, which is common, understood. Everyone is a fan of it. The Walking Dead has kind of taken that throne and gone further onto this. And K-Zack, jump in any time.
Well,
we're
getting in more in kind of a 28 Days Later type feel with this one.
Or Warm Bodies, even though that was a comedy. It's just, it's not your typical zombie movie.
Yeah, and like I said, I think we've gone past the typical zombie movie, because we can watch the George Romero references, but now what we're getting to see is really more of a human drama over illness and things like that. So we're getting to play on, you know, modern-day fears and things like that, losing your child, modern-day fears, and of course, you've got an aging Arnold Schwarzenegger, who, you know, isn't exactly going to be the super kick-ass guy he was, you know, 20 years ago.
Right,
and
right.
The big thing is this did well at the Tribeca Film Festival, has gotten a lot of buzz, and it's opening in the blockbuster season. It's opening on May 8th.
Mm-hmm.
So it's interesting, and this is coming out of going back to your earlier point, it's going back to a script that came out of this really interesting industry inside kind of ranking system. Maggie was a Blacklist screenplay, and Blacklist, in essence, these are all the scripts that they're so good, they've gone around town, people have passed up on it, and somehow or another they don't get made, but now some of them are getting made, like Maggie's one. Another one is, brace yourself guys, because I know you're gonna hate this, Mel Gibson. He made a movie called The Beaver about a guy who,
Jodie Foster,
about a guy who's, you know, he's a businessman, he's about to lose his, you know, business, got fired, he's losing his family, goes into a hotel room, gets a TV dropped on his head, and wakes up out of it all of a sudden trying to find his way through life with the help of a hand puppet. Now, I've read the script, and no screenplay is perfect, and it takes a lot to write a screenplay and then actually get it out there and shop it around.
Yeah, and if you remember, like, films like that were really, like, sought after, and this kind of leads into why certain films are just natural glides into the Academy. Because if you're a part of this Blacklist, it kind of gives you, like, a leg up in the competition, because these are kind of sought after. They can be the independent dark horse, is really where I'm coming from on that.
Maybe, maybe not, because here's the trick on that, is that it's not a guarantee that there's no guarantee any script's going to ever get made, and there's even a smaller, infinitesimally smaller chance that it's ever going to, you know, make it out to be an award.
Mm-hmm.
Dallas Buyers Club, I don't know if that made the Blacklist, but that certainly would have been a candidate for that kind of scenario.
So I didn't know if Horns strikes me as a film that would be a Blacklist script.
It's anything that reads well, because when the thing about screenplays that people don't, that aren't industry inside and just go to movies, don't care about how they get made, just that they're getting to see it, really don't necessarily know. But the idea is, when you write a screenplay, you're writing it to get it read by inside the industry, and you're writing it not necessarily for the audience, but to get past the reader who's going to read it for somebody. before right. it gets to actually get seen and shopped around.
Right. Right. There's a book out there that I haven't gotten to read yet by Thomas Lennon and Robert Ben Durant.
Yeah. Good one.
Who they're the guys who were first behind The State. They're behind a lot of the Night at the Museum and things like that. Mm-hmm. They're behind a lot of the movies, and their book was How to Make a Multi-Million-Dollar Movie. Which basically, you know why all the movies feel the same? Because they are. Hollywood is so scared to take chances on things like that that they keep on going back to the formula because going out of it isn't gonna keep people coming back.
It's a bad gamble sometimes,
right.
too.
Sometimes.
But right. Now, for you, you've gone through some of the blacklists. Are there two screenplays that have jumped out at you from the blacklist?
The titles that come out the most is I've read The Beaver, and I'm surprised it got made because it is really... It could have gone either way. It was trying to be a sweet family movie and also this demented, you know, exploration into someone's psyche breaking down.
Yeah, but Jodie Foster really pushed that thing through, man, especially for her friend who she was trying to help out.
Right, and the good news is about that is that they probably elevated that from the draft that we read at that point. Now, Maggie's the other one because it's a unique idea. It's a unique presentation. It had to have read well to make the list, and there's a ton of them that are still out there, still waiting in the wings, waiting for their chance.
Right, but I mean, a lot of studios will buy these scripts up to kind of keep them in development hell because, like I said, they don't want other studios to have them. They'll option them out, and they'll keep it going until it's dead.
Yeah, and that's true. And that's, the great thing is there's no one wrong way to get into Hollywood except to be a novice and not know and learn your craft. Because the truth is, once you do that and then get it around there, whether it's through the blacklist or making it yourself, like the director of Whiplash did, he made 15 minutes of that thing. And that's how he got the funding to make the full movie. So there's no one wrong way, but the blacklist, getting into that is what people are going to think, who think of screenwriting as a gimmick, are going to try to do to try to get something like Maggie made. And what they really need to do first is work on making that script good.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Well, speaking of that, I know Head Kaiju in Charge developed a little game for us about the summer movie. So I'll let
Let's play a game.
He's going to tell us more about
that's
it.
That's pretty good. Can you do that again?
Let's play a game.
I love this.
To ask each of our contestants to react to these random movie stills that are about to come up on your screen.
Let me give you a little music.
I'm just going to let him shake for a minute.
He's like, let him have his palsy. Get over with.
So I want to quickly just get your gut reactions to some of these summer blockbusters that are about to come out.
Okay.
So I might ask Jansen to put these up one at a time, the ones listed summer. And let's get your reaction. We'll start with an easy one. Let's go ahead and start with that one right there.
And then you want to go around the room and get each reaction? Okay.
I call that poster Sausage Party.
You're always about the superhero sausage. Come on.
There is one woman, and she's really tiny, and then I just see, like, man. But that's my reaction, but I'll still see it because I love Avengers. But
my reaction is I'm probably going to, I may just, you know, combust in the movie theater because they are attaching the new Force Awakens trailer to the beginning of
this.
So
they are.
Yeah.
And the KSAC, I think you and I are going to be taking a journey to the theater to see that too.
That is correct.
Oh,
membership has its benefits.
So, you go ahead.
Now let me explain that. The Jedigoddess crew has been invited to a pre-release screening, quite a few days pre-release too, and we've been invited by our friends at the House of Mouse to come out and check out the movie early and review
it. So, oh my god!
But yeah,
this is wow. this must be a big surprise because
we just found out about this the other day.
Oh yes. Wow! Oh,
and it was very limited seating. We couldn't get any more. They're on lockdown mode.
Oh, okay, cool.
So Chris is reacting on the air to like, why ain't I going? I ain't going either. Don't worry.
Well, no, I figured because you want to take the kiddo and stuff like
no,
that.
No, do you? But just don't tell me anything about it. That's all I ask.
No, I promise. We're gonna go see it again too, and all that good stuff.
Absolutely, because I'm gonna take my son, and my gut reaction to this is I can't flip and wait. But you guys go have a good time. Please have a good time.
This is so funny. We're having family drama on here. So let's move on to the next image.
I look at this and I go, I know what I'm getting. I'm looking forward to this one because it's exactly the Happy Meal that I'm looking for.
It is. Yeah. Honestly, the last one was great. This next one's going to be, I think, as much fun, if not
Let's go ahead and bring up the next image and watch you guys react to this one. Do you guys know what this is?
Uh-huh.
Yes, I do.
Okay, let's hear it.
There's a black torch.
There is a black torch. That's
true. I think that's cool, though. I think that's a really cool
element.
So they've
strayed away from canon a little bit.
They did. I think visually this looks really cool right here, but I don't know. The trailer didn't fulfill me, but this looks interesting. I was afraid it
would. For our audience members out there, what are we looking at?
Oh, Fantastic Four.
Sony's Fantastic Four.
Yeah.
No, Fox's Fantastic Four.
Foxes.
It's okay. So Sony's probably going to need a bailout from Fox, too, so don't worry.
A Marvel property not made by the Marvel Connected Universe right now.
Yeah.
But from the people who did X-Men Days of Future Past, Simon Kinberg's involved producing, writing. It's got a decent shot. I'm curious. That's my gut reaction. And you know what? There's been photos that have finally come to the internet to see the thing. And honestly, this thing looks better than the one from the Tim Story movies.
Okay.
That's not saying much.
I know.
I look at this and I think Richard Dreyfuss is making a mountain of mashed potatoes somewhere.
This means something.
Yeah. Okay. Appreciate it. Any last comments on this FF nonsense?
That's pretty much where I'm at. I mean, I'll still see it because of what it is, but it hasn't stirred me, but I think it's visually pretty.
Why can't they cast a blue-eyed girl for the Invisible Woman? I'm sorry, why?
Yeah, they're still not getting it right.
Is there a glut of blue-eyed, blonde-haired girls out there or something? Just saying.
There are
none in Hollywood.
Apparently.
Not in Hollywood, I'm
There's
sure.
Not anymore.
A bottle of bleach in the state. Okay, let's go to the next picture and get your gut reaction on the film that's attached to this.
Neener, 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 neener.
So this is the one about really big scaly dogs that get out of the park and eat people.
More like on steroids if you believe the spoilers.
Yeah, I didn't see the trailer for it, but there's one that's out there that a lot of people have been talking about the dialogue, and I purposely didn't watch it, but they were knocking the dialogue because they felt it was a little too overdone, rehash, you know.
Okay, my gut reaction, one word, reticent. I'm a huge Michael Crichton fan. I think it's great that they're returning to this. It's a different director who has only had one other film called Safety Not Guaranteed, which looked really good in the trailers. I haven't seen it.
I love that movie.
I've heard it's really good. It rhymes with Tomorrow, his last name, and that's how I think he got into Hollywood, but I'm joking. But with Jurassic World, it's... Do they need it, is the question. I think Universal's looking for franchises and grasping at straws.
I like Dallas Bryce Howard, though. I really like her as an actress.
Jason, are you a Jurassic fan?
Yes.
Yes.
Of the books. Although, they really screwed the pooch on Lost World. Because the book was so much better. And also, it should have ended in Jurassic Park. Because in the original book... what's his face? The owner of the park.
John Hammond.
John Hammond. He dies and gets eaten by the little Compisauruses at the end of the first book.
Yeah, he wasn't genuine, heartfelt benefactor that he was portrayed in the movie. But the difference, though, in The Lost World...
Spared at no expense.
Yeah.
Yes.
What I'm glad about with the second movie is that they didn't turn Ian Malcolm into a morphine addict like they did at the end of that book.
Yeah.
So. Okay, game show contestants, we have to go on to the next one. But
Zach, your reaction to
reaction to Jurassic World, Zach?
Meh.
Yeah, okay, great. All right, sums it up. All right, now I'm going to lay one hard on you. Are you ready? Look at this nonsense.
That looks like a Saturday.
At your house? Holy cow.
Oh, your second job. Okay.
Woo! If I'm doing it right.
So, thoughts on Mad Max Fury Road?
I'm going to quote the trailer.
I just like Charlize's cyborg arm.
I'm going to quote the trailer. Oh, what a lovely day. This is going to be fun.
Yeah. And, you know, that kind of leads into something I've been thinking about. You know, George Miller went ahead and what about this reboot fashion when it comes to the actual director of the original rebooting? Like, we have Sam Raimi and Bruce Campbell coming back with Evil Dead. Now you have Miller coming back and rebooting his entire Mad Max franchise. What's up with that? What are y'all's thoughts on that?
Well, the trick on that is, okay, we know what happens when somebody comes back to their own property and they create it in a vacuum. George Lucas.
No, okay, George does not count. George does
not
count.
Okay, that may be a different one. But, you know, going back
to the precedent.
Well, and Disney's kind of doing this a little bit about going back to their own well with movies like Maleficent and Cinderella. That's not the same thing as what you're talking about. Going back to the well works.
This is straight out for stripping it down and building it back up.
Well, and there's some value into that because, well, Robert Rodriguez and Quentin Tarantino tend to do it a lot, but here's the thing. It only works if you have something new to say. And Miller wouldn't have done this if he didn't have something new to say. So
okay, great Gibson. Point.
But
that's a good point.
At the same time,
hey,
I'm looking
I
at
love
the
Mel.
And at the same time, I'm looking at the trailer and I'm going, okay, four times in the desert. Can't this guy drive to a decrepit city like in I Am Legend and see what happens there? I'd love to see Mad Max show up in the ruins of Sydney, like at the end of Thunderdome, and try to find those kids.
I'm totally down for that if there's a another sequel. But
there will be.
Well, great, because, man, to take this back to... It looks like it's kind of a... Am I right? It looks like a combination between Road Warrior and Thunderdome.
And beyond, because of that dust storm with the lightning at one point in the trailer. Holy
shit. So I'm glad for him to come back and reestablish it. I think that's really, really cool. He's never had access to CGI. Mm-hmm. He's never had access to a $100 million budget
before. The budget right there is really interesting.
And Warner Brothers let him reshoot this thing. They let him, because stuff was coming out so good, they let him go longer in the shoot.
I think that's great, yeah.
I think the thing is, though, is that when you have the original creators in, you have at least some control for fans of the property. You basically, when you get that sign of approval and you get someone in charge and they're actually signing off on decisions being made, casting, crew, production, like Raimi and Tapert and Campbell were all very much into that new Evil Dead. And, of course, we've got the series coming out, and I think, you know, we'll probably get, you know, maybe one or two more movies. But the thing is that you're finally getting a seal of approval. And when the fans see that, they're going to go to this property. They're going to grab it on DVD. They're going to go to the theaters.
Right.
And it's Mad Max for a New Generation based on that alone.
And it's the same. Again, it's the same people behind it. So, you know, we have to, like you said, he may still have. What else has he not said that he's already said about it? Jason, do you have any input on the Fury Road and all that?
I really don't. I mean, I'm not a rabid Mad Max fan. Mm-hmm. I like the movies and stuff, but it's not one that's really just
stuck with you.
Yeah. So no, yeah. I have no opinion on that.
What about
I'll go see it.
Yeah, I look at the picture and I go, just walk away.
Translation from Jason, it's not Star Wars.
What about Evil Dead? Did you like Evil Dead?
I did not see the remake, but I love the original movies. So
okay.
I just haven't had time. I mean, there's so much stuff coming out so fast, and I have to get work done.
Well, everyone in our age bracket basically has money now, too.
And so, no time.
That's
why we binge watch on Saturdays.
Yeah, so that kind of goes into that, too.
Funny thing about binge watching, though, is that it might be a cure for ADD thanks to our cell phones. Mr. Gawk.
I'm going
to
hit you guys with one more.
Okay.
And this is it's great lead-in from your conversation about reinterpreting for new generation, because this particular franchise has been doing it for a long time now. And there's a question of, does it still have juice left in it? What is your reaction to this?
I'm all over it.
Yeah. You know, Tom Cruise, okay, and I know we mentioned, I'll bring Mel Gibson in, because on a personal level, I probably would not want to be in a room with these guys. But Mel Gibson is a good actor, good director. He's Tom Cruise, great actor as well. I mean, he can sell a role to me, and I think this is like that scene right there is kind of crazy.
It is.
I'll see it. I'll totally see it.
I'll tell you exactly why I'm absolutely excited is my word for this. But here's why: you got Chris McQuarrie directing, and I'm pretty sure he co-wrote the screenplay. He's working with Cruise, fresh off of Jack Reacher, and
which was awesome.
Yeah. Jack Reacher was the
bomb. I love Jack Reacher. That
and
was so good.
Best porn name ever.
And that's Jack Reacher.
And here's the funny thing: is that's coming
43.
We're coming off of a
like,
set
what
of films
movie
where.
Tom Cruise?
There you go. Yeah, I keep waiting.
Want to name it Travolta?
Oh, okay. Your thoughts, Mission Impossible.
Come on,
Konnichiwa.
I'm gonna get my money to San Andreas. Don't care.
Oh my God, you're
really?
Actually
you're not
see
down
that?
For MI?
No,
really?
I've never. I'm not.
No,
I'm
no,
not,
no, no.
I'm not into the MI franchises, but I'll go see San Andreas.
Have you liked any of them?
Huh? No.
Okay, I'm cool with that, but you're actually going to see San Andreas. Have you seen that trailer?
I have, and I'm looking forward to it. I want to see. I do want to see The Rock in like IMAX 3D with the.
Do you
want to
see The Rock lift the Earth and fix it?
What? And he will as Black Adam if that movie ever gets made.
See, this makes sense to me though, right? This makes sense to me because Kizak's a wrestling fan. He likes these big sweaty
man,
but I like
disgusting.
No,
oily bohunks. He's into oily bohunks.
I definitely want to see this whole disaster film. I want to see things blow up in like IMAX 3D. When I go to my summer film, I don't care about an intrigue. I don't want to sit there.
About intrigue?
Tom Cruise is hanging on the side of an airplane as it takes off.
I'd rather see Dar Robinson hanging off the edge of the hotel in Sharky's machine. I'm sorry, I don't care enough about Tom Cruise or this franchise to go see it. I'm going to give my money to San Andreas.
Very cool. I'll be honest, San Andreas, I saw that trailer and I'm like, Really? Volcano 2 got made?
But this is from a man who loves ID4, by the way. I just want to put that
out. Hey, that's a summer movie that falls in line with his argument.
But the thing is that there are a bunch of other summer movies that I'm going to go take a look at, because we were talking about going through summer movies.